Welcome. So I'm going to talk about serverless and in general, but also Cloud Run in specific. This is the outline of my talk. I want to talk about Cloud Run, but I want to set the stage a little bit because I want to explain what serverless is like and what you can benefit from if you use serverless with respect to the alternative running your own VM. Of course, I have some demos prepared, some basic demos just to make you feel get a feel of how it works. And if we're lucky, if we have enough time, I can also do some continuous deployment as an example. So, who am I? I'm Dennis Geurts. I come from the Netherlands. I work at a company in the Netherlands called Luminis. It's a tech company, but most of the time I'm detached at another company. I'm a GD on IoT, but I also like cloud and Android, so that's also one of my interests. So serverless. What I really would like from this talk is that if we're done, that afterwards you think, okay, I want to try this. I want to go home and go try Cloud Run, serverless, and any of these propositions. But what is serverless? Serverless is the notion or the concept that instead of deploying a complete application, you just deploy one single function. And this function has only one means, and it does it really, really well. That's what serverless is like. So instead of deploying a complete application, where you have to think about everything and all the interactions, you only have, when you deploy a serverless function, you only have to think about what's inside this function. What's the functionality of this function? These functions, they have some drawbacks. The drawbacks are that you don't have. Let's go to the positive side. Because there's no application, you have to somehow react to something because the function has to be invoked. Normally, a function is invoked using an application, but here there's no application. So how do you invoke such a function? Usually, that's done using HTTP calls. But you also have PubSub, for instance, and other events available. And because you're in the environment of the Google Cloud platform, if you have the right permissions set on the function, then it's also allowed to call upon other Google services without any interaction. We don't have to log in. So that's all taken care of in the meta data of the project. Because you're not using an application, there's no idle time for your application. So if the serverless, there's only CPU power dedicated to your function as long as the function is running. So outside of the function, there's no CPU power, there's no CPU resources available for your application, for your function. Then the drawbacks, of course. You don't have a file system. You really, really have to make sure that your application is stateless, because the next invocation of your function, you will not know if it's the same instance. Probably it will not be the same instance. You're limited in execution time, so you have roughly about 15 minutes to do something. Well, for an HTTP call, that's very long. So. I don't really consider that a drawback. Another drawback might be if your application requires it, you don't have TCP, UDP access. If you need it, that's a bummer. But if you don't, then there's no problem there. Because you're not building a complete application, your application, the set of functions that you deploy becomes an application. And that's really hard to fathom sometimes. You have to really know how these functions interact with each other. So that's increased management overhead for you. And the CPU, well, like I said, CPU is only available during execution time, so you cannot spin off a new thread and think, okay, I'll just return a response to the user or to the invoking instance and then go on executing the job. That's not possible. So you have to take that into consideration while building the functions. So the standard functions that Google provides are the serverless functions. They can react on HTTP triggers, and like I said, PubSub triggers and Google Cloud Storage triggers. So instead of if you for instance upload a file to your application, you would expose some web call, and you upload the file, and then the application will upload this file to some file system and start processing the file. Using serverless functions, you can just put it on Google Cloud Storage, for instance, and that's just one call, and this one call is really dedicated to saving this file to cloud storage, and that's it for that function. A next function you will react on the Google Cloud event, on the Google Cloud Create event, and then process the file either directly or using PubSub to figure out what to do with the file. So right now there are three types of programming languages you can use for serverless functions. So the top one is in Go, the middle one is in JavaScript, Node.js, and the bottom one is in Python. So you can pick your language, and it's really this simple. This would be if you do a print line "Hello World" over here, you're good to go. You would be able to deploy this function. For PubSub messages, I just took one message, programming language. For PubSub, you get a PubSub message, and the data inside you can use, and the data can be protobuf, it can be JSON. Who cares? That's up to you. It's your responsibility to send correct data to that endpoint. Deployment of these functions is also very simple. You just go to your console and type gcloud deploy, and you're good to go. This is an example for an HTTP trigger endpoint. So when this is done, then you get an endpoint URL back, and you can invoke it. Other ways of deployment is using a Google Cloud Platform console. You just go to the console, you press on create a function, and then there's already some boilerplate code available there. So you can just with the press of the button, you can start working with cloud functions. If you really want, you can also do REST calls and the source repository part. I'll get to that later. So then there's Firebase. Firebase, of course, also supports the default Google Cloud function, but also has a lot of other triggers available. You have to know that in the Google Cloud Platform, there are lots of events that are being emitted, and just a few of them are exposed here. But lots of these events, if you know the event, you can bind a trigger to it. And then this trigger is either sent to PubSub or handled by something else, and it depends on the event that you capture. The payload depends on the type of trigger you generate. And the Firebase works in JavaScript, uses JavaScript as a language, so that's a drawback if you don't like JavaScript. So in Google Cloud Firestore triggers, they look like this. So this, for every event that happens upon a document, you can capture this event. Or if you're interested in one of the specific events, you can capture them only that one. And deployment is also very, very easy, just a one-liner. So a Google Cloud function, an instance for every invocation of the Google Cloud function, an instance is created. And it is used, and it cannot be reused at the same time that the call is going on. So if you do two calls instantaneously, there will be two instances of your function. But of course, you don't care because it's auto-scaling. And trigger endpoints are not secure. You have to roll your own security. But 2 weeks ago, they installed IAM, Identity and Access Management, on Cloud Function as well. So that's really nice. So if you really want authenticated calls, it's a metadata layer on top of the definition of your function. So that's serverless. You can also go to a platform as a service called App Engine, which is more like a web application that you build, and it contains triggers. It has a queue. It has some notion of data storage, and you have lots of languages that you can use, at least more than three, and. You get 28 instance hours for free every day. So you can run one instance for free for a whole day and do some background processing for 4 hours. So 24 plus 4 is 28, right? It also auto-scales, of course, and you can assign custom domains to it. So your user base doesn't have to know about that you're running on Google Cloud. Just you can hide it behind the custom domain, and then there's this last option. You can just roll your own VM. It's really nice because then you have access to TCP and UDP protocol. But if you don't need it, if you really need UDP and or TCP, you can go to a dedicated instance. It's not auto scaling. You have to. Make sure you keep the OS up to date, and all the management is your responsibility. So, quick question: who knows about Docker? Okay, because now we're getting to the Cloud Run part, and it's pretty essential that you know what Docker is. Docker is a CH-rooted environment where. You build a container that contains an OS, a kernel, and every and a file system and everything that you need to run your application, and not more, nothing more. That's it. And then you can pick up this container and run it anywhere. That's really 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 nice. So this is what a container would look like. So you have a kernel, then some operating system. The Debian and Ubuntu are quite large. Alpine is really, really small. And then on top of that, you have your favorite language available, or program language, or anything else, and your application, and that's it. And if you want to create a web application, all you have to do is just expose a port and listen on that port and react on it. Using any language you like. So Cloud Run is exactly that. You just build a container using the language of choice. You expose it at this HTTP service on port 8080. Well, the environment variable port, but usually that's 8080. Then you have to push that image that container that you created. You have to push it to a repository so that the Google Cloud platform can access it, because otherwise the Google Cloud platform doesn't know where to get this image from. And then once it's deployed, you deploy the container just by a simple command, again gcloud. So in the services landscape, there's serverless, there's App Engine, and a dedicated VM, and I think, to me, it more or less bridges the gap between serverless and the platform as a services. What's missing here in the picture is Kubernetes. Actually, it's there because Google Cloud runs on Kubernetes. It's built upon Knative, which makes use of Kubernetes. So if you compare Cloud Functions to Cloud Run, well, they're pretty much the same. The only real benefit of Cloud Run is, of course, that you can build your own container. And the benefit of Cloud Functions is that the pub sub and the cloud storage events triggers are available immediately just for you to do. In Cloud Run, it's a little bit more work because you have to first expose the HTTP endpoint, and then you have to assign the trigger to that HTTP endpoint. Where Google Cloud Functions only doesn't allow for concurrent use of an instance, for Cloud Run that's doable. You can have up to 80 concurrent requests to the same instance, if your application allows for it, resource wise. So the difference between triggering a PubSub message with respect to the functions part is that you get a little bit of extra metadata around the message structure as it is defined. But it's a web call. I mean, you get a request and you have a response, and you just read data from the request and then respond to it. That's all there is to it. And well, for billing, it's really funny. 180,000 virtual CPU seconds. I think that's about four days of virtual CPU per day. So you don't really have to pay a lot of money to get started with this. My bills are below $1 per month, and that's just for my pet projects, of course. But it's really not expensive, and this is what it looks like if you do have multiple concurrent requests to your service. You're only billed for the blue part of the request, so it's not that you're billed twice for the because you have two requests. If you want to create a Docker container or image, you have to create it using a Docker file. And I have some examples of Docker files here. This is you always start from a base image, and in this case you start with a base image that already has Nginx inside, and then you just add a configuration. And the configuration, for instance, means that you have to set the port it listens on and stuff. And if you have some static content, you put it also into the onto the file system of the container, and then you just run Nginx and it's running. You might have a Java application, then you need an image with a kernel and an OS and of course a JRE to get started. But then all that's needed is an application jar that you can run. So you put it into the image, and you're good to go. This setup probably ends up with an image that's 500 megabytes. So that's quite a lot. You can go lower using volumes by using Alpine and the JRA version of this. You can go to about 100 megabytes. Or you can, if you use Go, you can go to a single static binary, and so you have to do some more advanced stuff. You have a builder phase and a work phase, and so you first build the application by using the run method. That's it. And when that's done, you start from scratch. And Scratch is an empty image, so there's nothing in there. There's no kernel. There's no OS. There's no file system. The file system is completely empty. And what you then do is copy the executable the binary from the first image to the next image, and then you're left with a container of about 8 megabytes. So that's really, really impressive. So I want to do some demos. This is the script that I'm going to run right now for several different example projects. This step is locally, so you build your own container that you have to do on your own on your own laptop. Probably that takes the longest. Then the next step is to make it publicly available, or not publicly, privately available to Google. And well, that takes some time, because if you have 100 megabytes, you have to push 100 megabytes. If you have 8 megabytes, well, you only have to push 8 megabytes. And if you go to really high numbers, high data sizes, then it takes of course considerably longer. And then the deploy step. It looks complicated, but it's if you look at the lines, you just have to define the project. Of course, well, which project do you want to deploy it to? You have to allow for unauthenticated access. And you have to specifically say that it will be a public service. The concurrency is some set of concurrency, and if you don't put it, I think it's default at 80. Platform is managed to say, okay, I'm not going to deploy this on my own Kubernetes Knative environment or on Anthos. And you have to specify the region. So if you know that your user base is in Europe, then you deploy this function in Europe, this cloud, this container in Europe. But if you want to access the people in the US, you deploy it in the US. And then the image, of course, the image you just created on top, you have to specify it to. Otherwise, it doesn't know. It doesn't know which image to deploy. And I didn't change the slides yet, but 2 days ago it says here Google Cloud Beta run, but 2 days ago it got general available. So that's a good sign. So it's not beta anymore. Google thinks it's production ready. So I'm just starting first with a small Kotlin example. So it's now using a Java 8 JDK to build this Gradle application. It will result in a jar file. And this takes some time, of course. It depends on what kind of project you have. Pushed. Yeah. Yeah, we're deploying. So this is the only part that's taking time to deploy it. The other stuff is just preparation. Hmm? And really don't know what's going on with the Gradle one. Odd. And there we go. So we have an URL over there, which I can copy. The other one is going as well. Finally, we decided to. So that's the Python. That's the Python one. Здравствуйте, right? Yeah. So the other one is already is deploying right now, so we can wait for that to happen. And I have also a Node.js application that we can. That one builds also very fast. Boom. That's nice. A But as you can see, the preparation time takes longer than the actual deployment. And the preparation is, of course, over this Wi-Fi is suboptimal. We'll get back to that in a few minutes. I'd like to go to the last part, because as you can see, the deployment takes some time, the building takes some time, and well, as a developer, you don't constantly want to wait. So there's also cloud build, and cloud build allows you to define some set of Docker containers that will run on your code base every time there's you deploy some source code to the source repository, and then based on the definition that's inside your project, these containers will act upon your project. And there's some inception ahead, because here we're going to create a Docker container in a Docker container using Docker containers. So this is a definition of a project I also have ready for hopefully the demo. So it's just a YAML file that you put into your source repository, and then you register your source repository to the to Cloud Build, and it. Again, it looks more daunting than it really is, because all it does is say which image you should build or act upon your source code. And the first image is a gsutil command, is a container that has gsutil, and all it has to do is copy some Google Cloud Storage file into a data directory. So that's what's happened in the first line. Next, we're going to build the container. So it's Docker build minus T with the image name, so that you can push it to the Docker container, to the GCR repository, which is the third step, and then we deploy it. So that's really there all there is to it. And let's try to do that as well. This one is ready, so we can open this link. We can first look at that one. Priet, Mir. So that's also working, and this one is also working. So the Kotlin version. So where's that? That's over here, right? I walked the stairs, so down and up. So. Just to get this picture taken, and if you want, you can go to this link, and then you will see the image yourself. Yeah, you got it already, or it's a beautiful image. Let's not go there then. So this is the. I'll close this one so that we have the full screen. So this is a data directory where my source code for the movie is contained. So what I do is git commit minus amend. That's what everybody does, right? And then git push minus F. Ooh. So that's a change, that's a code change. So now we can go to console. I can go to the console. Yes, leave it. And lo and behold, there's a there's a build running, and it takes a few minutes. But then now you just push your code, and if it's on the master branch, for instance, it goes to you deploy your application to one side, the function, and if it's developed, you go to a different part. And you can add, of course, lots of tests before the actual deployment happens. So we'll just let this run, and we can come back to this. But that's it. Thank you.